speaker this morning is Paul Gillespie, and he's going to talk about the perfect DevOps storm. Take it away, Paul.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. So how is the sound level? Can everyone hear me? All good? Excellent. Right, so I'm Paul. I'm a senior principal engineer at Skyscanner, and I'm the type lead for our development agent type. So for those of you who don't know, Skyscanner was founded in Edinburgh back in 2003. Started as a spreadsheet, funnily enough, it was an Excel spreadsheet. And we've grown quite a bit, as you may have seen. And we're now we're a global travel research site. We have over 60 million travels a month. And yeah, I think it's been an interesting journey over the last however many years it is. So what I'm going to talk about today is a number of the changes that we've gone through over the last few years. There's been a lot of transformation in the organisation. We've done a lot of interesting things, I think, and I'm going to talk to you about what we've done. However, it's worth pointing out that this may not be applicable to your organisation, so think carefully about the lessons that we've gone through and the lessons that we've learned. They may not apply to you. So before we start, there's some terminology that we'll go through. If you're familiar with SWOT 5, SWOT application, you'll care a lot about this. But these are terms that we use a lot in Skyscanner. I'll use them a lot in the presentation. So a squad. So a squad is that's what we call teams in Skyscanner. That's like the actions of your organization. And it's autonomous teams. They have specific goals. And they have some interesting names in Skyscanner as well, so there's plenty of stories behind some of the names that we give our squads. Squads are organised into tribes, so that's alignment of like-minded as teams who have common goals all grouping together to become a higher level goal, essentially. And in Skyscanner we also have the process of enablement. And that's what we call the development of tooling and services for the rest of the organisation. That kind of underpins a lot of what we do. And it's kind of one of the outcomes of all the changes that we've gone through over the last couple of years. So, what is the perfect DevOps storm? So, when I first heard about this conference, I thought, yeah, it's a great opportunity to talk about the changes that we have gone through. And that got me to think about how that actually felt and the almost chaotic nature of it, and the fact that we went through so many changes in such a short period of time. It just felt like there was one change after another. You sometimes thought you weren't going to have time to leave. You know, there was strain in the organisation. It just felt like, you know, what next? Can we cope? And the analogy that I came up with on Saturday night after a bottle of wine was, this kind of felt like a storm. There was so much kind of happening together, there was so much things coming all at the same time. So that's kind of where I arrived at the time for this talk. So what the perfect DevOps storm for Skyscanner was the convergence of lots of fairly large changes to the way that we work, the way we organise ourselves, the way that we deliver software, and the technologies that we use over a relatively short period of time. So the interesting thing is to ask why. Why do we go through the pain of all of these changes that we've made to our organisation? And one of the themes that runs through many of these changes is a desire to increase the speed of execution. There's a kind of phrase that goes around Skyscanner. It's going from an idea to a user in an afternoon. And what that means is that we want to be able to have an idea in the afternoon. End of the day, we actually want to have that idea in the hands of our users in some form. And to do that, you have to have an organization that can support that. You have to have the processes that can support that. You also have to have the technology that which kind of depends on that kind of mindset and way of delivering software. So I kind of, I guess it's not a classic reason for adopting DevOps principles. It really, it's about speeding up how quickly you can get the ideas out of your heads and in front of your customers, and most importantly, get the feedback back to your organization as well to understand how well the product is doing. Is the new feature that you've got on the site, does it actually make any money? Or does it benefit your users? Feedback can also come in the form of availability monitoring, performance monitoring, etc. So there is this interesting feedback cycle that you have to kind of consider as well. But at the end of the day, we really want to optimize the delivery of our ideas and to get them out to our users as quickly as possible. So the timeline we're talking about for the changes that I'll go through is it's about 3.5 years. There's 12 major changes that I remember. I'm sure there are more. And as I said, they are focused on organization, process, and technology. This doesn't include all of the product changes that we have to make. It doesn't include the way that users have changed the way they consume our services. It doesn't include industry trends. So there's an entire spectrum of other changes that we're also going on at the same time. So, 2014. This was quite a busy year. So this is the year of Spotification came out, which we'll talk about in a minute. But the first the major change, which is worth calling out, was the move to continuous delivery. This was the first time that we started to think about squads and operating autonomously. When I joined the Skyscanner, it was 6 weeks to deliver the monolith, and sometimes that would keep up to 7 to 8 weeks if there were problems. So there was an effort put in place to actually think about continuous delivery and think about what that would mean for squads tooling in place, and also to start to break up the monoliths. The next big change that we had was the pivot to open source technology. And for many years, Skyscanner had been known as a .NET shop, but we recognised that there was a vast amount of open source technology that we could really sort of develop and grow at scale. And we decided to essentially embrace everything that we could get our hands on to give us more capabilities, to give us more options as to how we work. That was an interesting time because there was an explosion in the use of technology, which we'll come back to towards the end of the talk. Squadification. So this is probably one of the biggest sort of changes that we were on in Skyscanner. This was effectively changing how everything worked in the organization. It started in product engineering around 2014. This was the we were really wanting to bring in autonomous teams to focus in on being able to deliver software quicker, and it's all about the scope of execution piece. And it's spread across the organization. So now we have every team in Skyscanner is a squad. We have multiple tribes. It goes from product engineering to finance, to commercial, to legal. Everyone operates as a squad. They have specific missions, they set goals. By and large, we all use agile processes in one shape or another. So it's not just a thing for software or for operations. The other kind of big change that we had in 2014 was we decided to start building a data platform. And this wasn't probably the most impactful thing in terms of like disruption to the organization, but it underpins pretty much everything that we do on a day-to-day basis right now. So it was a very sort of significant step at the time. And now we have a data platform that handles terabytes of data a day, and you'll find that data is consumed in many, many different places across Skyscanner. So, 2015, we decided it was time to get some of this cloud stuff, and that was another really significant change to the way that we work. So we moved from a static. You know, it was all pretty orderly in terms of how you provision your infrastructure. Suddenly you pivot across to infrastructure, which was an API, essentially. And that opened up lots of possibilities. It allows you to provision infrastructure really quickly, but it also brought in a number of challenges, which obviously is the, how we operate that in that environment. Right now we have hundreds of services running in AWS. We're operating in multiple AWS regions, but we still have huge amount of services running in data centers as well. Another kind of significant change that started to creep in 2015 was that we really thought about how we were building products and how we validate our assumptions of our products, and that manifested itself focus on experimentation. So we've used the Optimizely for a long time, and it's kind of we got to a point where it didn't scale, and there was some interesting financials behind that as well. So we decided to build our own experimentation platform so that we could scale out how we do new tests. And this had a kind of profound impact on the way the product owners and the squads actually thought about how they develop the products for our users. So we actually have to think about what impact is this actually have on specific KPIs. How you can't just sort of assume that your product feature is going to make a difference. So where we are now with that is we have hundreds of experiments that have run each month. We have 40 to 50 squads that are using experiments on a daily basis. So 2016, that's us back to kind of normal rate of change at Skyscanner. So we've been in this sort of squadification model for 18 months now, and it's become apparent that we actually need to start thinking about how we enable other parts of the business. There was a lot of time and effort getting used to do the same thing over and over again. So we took the opportunity to perform trials which were essentially focused on providing services for the rest of the building, the rest of the organization. And a lot of the type that I work in the developer enablement, that allowed us to start focusing on our deployment processes, how we tackle microservices, how we tackle security experimentation is part of that as well, how we operate on the AWS. And that was the decision to actually sort of form these specific tribes for folks on the ways that we coped with all of the changes that we started to introduce. Other big change, 2016, microservices. Everyone started to kind of jump on this bandwagon. The interesting thing you get when you have lots of autonomous teams is that they like to build their own services. They don't particularly like to share their services. So you have an explosion of the number of services that you have to support. All the reasons for doing this, you can decouple. You can have much smaller code bases. You can focus on specific problems. But it does bring a lot of challenges when you move into the operation space. So it's definitely not a free lunch. And the patterns that we saw were, it wasn't just monolith getting broken down, it was actually new, native microservice architectures getting built on AWS as well, which was interesting. So, and I guess an example of the scale that we have for our microservices is there are single features on our site which have 20 plus services backing them. So there's some fairly sort of fine-grained microservice architectures in operation in Skyscanner. You build it, you run it again. It's another. It's almost a kind of a. It kind of goes hand in hand with having lots of the partners teams, because you can build so much. There's no way you can have a central organization actually managing all the services that are in production. You have to delegate that responsibility down to the individual teams, because at the end of the day, it's those individual combining that with the move to AWS, that again, you have a huge amount of flexibility in how you provision your infrastructure. You can give that power to your teams, but you have to do it in a way which is responsible, in a way where you don't cause lots of production incidents. So, 2017, bang up to the current time. We had a bit of a revelation at the start of the year that because we're building lots of microservices, we're really building distributed systems. So, if anyone has had any experience with distributed systems, you know you're going to get a lot of pain with the network and the failure pieces that we feed into your systems. So we had to start thinking about how we coped with the increasing dependencies that we had between systems. We had to start thinking about the different failure modes that we experienced, specifically in cloud. A lot of weird stuff happens in AWS. No matter what you say, weird things happen, and sometimes don't have any explanation for that. So you have to be able to deal with the failures. You also have to be able to deal with the dynamic nature of these environments as well. Everything's changing underneath your feet all the time, and also you're changing your software all the time. You're continually pushing software. You've got continuous deployment process in place, pushing new features out. So it's something that's amazing that actually everything works the way it should be. But this sort of change was probably. It felt like, I guess we're kind of ahead of the curve at this point. I think we've gone through 2.5 years of a lot of change, a lot of things, having to adapt a lot of different ways of doing things. And at this point, I think we are kind of ahead of the curve. Another kind of interesting thing that happened this year was that we started to think quite seriously about how we should view standards in our organization, how we should actually be able to define ways that we work, actually how we can apply that to an organization. And that's been an interesting experience, and there's some interesting lessons that we have learned with that process. So, some of the lessons that we have learned over the last couple of years, and as I said at the start, your mind is new here, so think carefully about some of the topics that we've discussed. When we started doing this certification, we approached it with a perspective of, we're going to get this right the first time. We're not going to have to change it. That was complete nonsense. I think we are probably maybe 3 or 4 iterations into what we now call our organization structure. And it did take took many attempts actually to get to a point where it was stable, and we actually had something which an organization which actually could deliver on, I guess, the promises of certification. One of the initial problems that we had was that we became slowly stated to KPIs. We very much focused on metrics rather than actually focusing on the goal and actually what you're trying to accomplish in the squad. And probably still to this day, we are still struggling with collaboration and communication across squads. It can be very difficult to align multiple squads, especially out with tribes. Some of the things you don't necessarily hear a lot about with the Spotify model is that you do have to think about changing things quickly and be able to respond to different things, different business goals that you want to accomplish. So don't think of your squads as fixed resources. One of the techniques that we use is we will have pop-up squads. We will take individuals from different squads and combine them together for a period of time. You do have to kind of be aware of service ownership issues at that point, but it does allow you to move quickly. one of the other interesting patterns that we've seen are some tribes have super squads, common clans that are Scottish in there, and really they're large teams which are focused on reasonably big problems. So we see this quite a lot in our infrastructure space, specifically in our data infrastructure. A couple of great quotes here. Uncle Ben from Spider-Man. Great power comes great responsibility. And this is a bit of autonomy, essentially. Just because you're an autonomous team doesn't mean that you don't have responsibilities. They go hand in hand. You have a lot of things that you can think about if you're given the autonomy to operate independently. And the other interesting quote we have is from Ken Beck, is that autonomy without accountability is just a vacation. You know, there's a customer, at the end of the day, you're responsible to your customer. You have to think about what's best for them. It's not necessarily about an interesting technology. It's not about you have to think about the full software delivery, for example. You have to think about how you collaborate with other parts of your business. So it's an important sort of counter point to accountability, is that there is responsibility with that as well. Great book here, I thoroughly recommend it, Turn the Ownership Around. But the point here is that just because you make a team autonomous doesn't necessarily mean that they have the ability to do everything you think they should do. And we saw this with AWS. We gave squads access to AWS, huge toolbox of services, and boy, did we have lots of different ways of doing things after doing that. So you have to think about how you enable squads to be successful in their autonomous. Education is a big important part of that. Turn the ship around is an interesting concept of certification for operators. Not tried that yet, but it's an interesting concept. As I've said before, unfortunately, we have been able to create enabling squads at Skyscanner. There's a number of different enabling squads that they have. Change fatigue. This is something which is probably, you don't talk about it a lot, I guess, in the community, but it is a very big problem. If you're continually changing technology, continually changing processes, and you have product squads who are trying to deliver software, you're basically giving them a lot of time to build and really making their lives difficult if you don't consider how you go from old process to new process, old software to new software. It's something that we struggle with, and it's something that we've become much more aware of over the past 6 months. Continuous improvement, definitely that's the theory of constraints. It works. Can't recommend this enough. If you are, I guess, kind of new to DevOps, it's a good place to start. The Phoenix project, that's probably a bit more approachable to go, but both excellent books. So from an enable perspective, it's very easy to think that you know best because you were once your customer. So you do need to make a concerted effort, actually reach out to the rest of the organisation, actually figure out what the real problems are, and actually listen to their points of pain, and to not assume that you know best. Again, that is an ongoing challenge for the enabling tribes and Skyscanner. You build it, you run it, and you most definitely own it. Is an interesting concept in that we have lots of squads who like to build stuff, and they sometimes don't like to use shared services. So you do have to have, I guess, kind of conversations about, you know, it's fine. You're still operating your service, even though you're consuming other services. You do this again, you work with AWS. Use a third-party service, so why does it make any difference if you're running on a shared container and cluster which is provided by another group versus building your own one? So again, there's some interesting cultural learnings that you have from that. standards. So, one of the reasons that we're so interested in standards is that it allows us to kind of eliminate duplication and to let the organisation benefit from doing something once and then sharing it across a large number of teams, economies of scale and there. Consistency is also another interesting side effect that you get from starting to apply standards, and also makes it easy to move between squads as well. If the service looks the same structurally in one squad and move in another squad, it becomes a lot easier to pick things up. From a standards perspective, we have found that you definitely need to be restrictive at first. It's very easy to limit what you can provide and then to start giving extra points. You need to measure how you actually provide standards. And to track adoption, track life cycle of standards. One of the interesting things that I've found is that internal open source is a great way to scale delivery. Even with certification, you will never get the perfect structure. You're always going to have some point to share code, and making that process easy to do, and actually optimizing that process can be one of the low hanging fruit, I guess, and actually speeding up. Technology. So one of the easiest ways to get standards adoption is to make it free. So we have one of the examples here is we have something called the M-Shell, which is a set of components templates for building microservices and a Skyscanner. Very easy to get service in production and do all we can see. So microservices. Definitely not an excuse to write a book or out of your CV, or to get a speaking gig, but I think there's definitely a huge amount of value for microservices, but the problem that we have had with microservices is that we didn't necessarily have the best of the environment which we're designed to support it. So, you have to consider logging, you have to consider server discovery, security, how you manage traffic, there are a huge amount of overhead from an operational perspective. Services, so I guess be wary of that. Finishing up, technology. So we made a critical mistake when we said let's go for open source technology. We didn't put any bounds on that, there were no restrictions. We said fill your boots, and lots of smart engineers, they sat in the buildings. There was a huge explosion of different technologies. And that made it really difficult to standardize things and actually get the two benefits of having sort of centrally managed components or centrally managed environments. It was very, very difficult to scale up that side of the business. So I would implore you to think really, really carefully about the amount of technologies that you adopt at any one time and to think about how you manage that process. So wrapping up, I think we've gone through a huge amount of change. It has certainly improved our organisation, but it's just a journey. It's not the sort of the DevOps nirvana at the end of it. Autonomy is brilliant, but it needs to go hand in hand with responsibility, and you do need to consider your customers at all times. Standards like the scale, so there's always going to be something you will have to factor standards, I'm sure, at the moment. Think about formalizing them a bit, and then think about how you automate that, or how you make that easy for people to adopt. If you can, invest in an enablement. Actually have one engineer, two engineers, a small team, a group focused on providing services for the rest of your engineering organization to help speed up how they work. And I guess the classic quote there, change is the only constant, it's very true. I think when I first started thinking about this talk, I thought, yeah, this is an anomaly. office, this should be the case, but it really is. I think this is just the default state. If you actually want to operate at scale, operate at that speed, you are going to be thinking about how you change the way you work a lot. So that's it. Huge amount of stuff delivered quite quickly. I guess are we good for questions or should we wrap up? Sorry, no questions now, but I will be here all day, happy to take any questions. Thank you very much.